Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Yuletide Blend by Kennedy Layne. Narrated by Annalyse McCoy. Chapter 1. The fragrant scent of fresh-cut pine from the huge selection of Christmas trees hung in the air as eager families searched for just the perfect Yuletide tree to celebrate the holiday. The crowded, crushed limestone lot had its perimeter surrounded by long strands of winking colored lights. Street lamps provided enough illumination on two sides of the corner lot, and a couple of overhead floodlights pointed toward the back, over the tree bundling machine, to light up the cashier's table. Selecting the perfect tree from the traditional mom and pop operations was just part of the many fun festivities going on in the busy town square of Paramour Bay. In the summer, the owners ran a small farmer's market out of this location that provided many of the townsfolk with produce. Today, they were supplying part of the Christmas joy to all the families awaiting one very special morning. Most of the fun activities were all tied around certain events, like the snowman building competition, or who could make the most original gingerbread house. There was even a small man-made ice rink for those who wanted to skate. Technically, the round area was the small pond in the center of the park that had frozen over. A local vendor had donated the money to build a portable shack to rent skates and sell hot apple cider to patrons. Several children had constructed bunkers for the ultimate snowball battles once there had been enough snowfall. It was up to the parks department to keep the combatants contained to willing participants. A well-controlled nightly bonfire was being monitored by the volunteer fire department. Somebody was on watch from 6 until 10 every weekday night, even earlier on weekends. As a matter of fact, a group of Christmas carolers were currently swaying back and forth around the warm blaze as they belted out yet another familiar song. I hadn't even mentioned the town's 24-foot Christmas tree that already had a lighting ceremony last weekend. Red and gold silk ribbon had been carefully woven between the many branches, and a star that was brighter than an authentic one had been positioned at the very tip-top. Our local electrician, Ned Gardner, made sure all the colored lights, nativity scene, and our Star of Bethlehem were in good working order prior to every season. Almost every resident had come to watch the captivating display transform our small town park into a Norman Rockwell version of a Christmas winter wonderland. Truthfully, the beautiful blue spruce pine was the fullest I'd ever seen in such a large tree. That was saying a lot, considering that I'd lived in New York City most of my life, and the Kennedy Center did the whole holiday tree thing to the limit. Anyway, our town's Christmas tree had even been decorated with the founding family's ornaments from many years past, putting a special touch on the ceremony as something new from each family was added each year. It was Christmas time in our small coastal Connecticut town, and the council had gone all out this year. They'd somehow created the perfect winter retreat, and I was loving every minute of it. Granted, I was a witch. Christian holidays weren't usually our time to shine, but the winter solstice was just 4 days prior to Christmas. Of course, I had grown up with the standard Santa stories. I'd learned to appreciate the season for a time of giving and a time of celebration. My favorite holiday was Halloween, but Christmas fell right behind at a comfortable distance. There was something very magical about this time of year, and I didn't mean that to be a pun of any sort. I adjusted my scarf a bit to prevent the bitter coastal breeze from hitting my neck directly, mindful of the hot coffee steaming in my left hand. There were no vendor booths selling caffeinated beverages or snacks. There was just hot chocolate for the kids. For those special grown-up drinks, the residents needed to head into one of the local stores. This way, the mom-and-pop shops benefited from any tourists passing through this holiday season. The council members had been wise about only permitting a certain number of electrical access points to maintain a comfortable setting for the children to visit Santa Claus. His area was by far the most magical of all. A gold and silver glittered path had been created throughout what was supposed to be an enchanting walk through the North Pole. An unused snowmaking machine had been stationed next to the mechanical displays of automated polar bears, reindeers, and elves. Mother Nature had provided all the snow we'd ever need this year. The animatronics could be seen moving their heads in adorable ways, some of them actually mimicking the act of loading presents in a large sleigh. Young and old alike got a kick out of the holiday exhibits. The mayor had even been permitted a rescue game park to bring in a small petting zoo with real, live reindeer. It had been the hit of this year's Christmas Winter Wonderland thus far, although nothing beats Santa Claus and the starry-eyed boys and girls lining up to tell him what was on their wish list this year.
Bah, humbug.
Just admit it, I said from behind my scarf. You miss Skippy and his friends this time of year. There's nothing wrong with that, you know. They probably miss you, too.
I'll admit to no such thing. They can all go choke on acorns.
While I was attempting to locate the handsome sheriff of our quaint little town, I should probably introduce myself and my cantankerous feline familiar. If he kept up this attitude, I'd have to start calling him the Grinch. Or just give him the present I'd bought for him a couple of weeks early. Christmas was still 15 days away, and Leo's Christmas spirit needed some adjusting.
I won't say no to the gift, if that's what you're worried about. I'm open to bribes.
My familiar's real name is Leo, and I'm Raven Lattice Marigold. This was my second Christmas in Paramour Bay, thanks to my grandmother. I honestly owed her for everything I had right now. From my magical abilities to my small tea shop business on the main thoroughfare of town. There was even the quaint little cottage she'd bequeathed to me in her will. My home sat on the far edge of town, just a stone's throw from the bay.
Why do I suddenly feel like chopped liver? And that is Mr. Leo to the listeners. Thank you very much.
I held back a laugh as I searched the crowd, grateful that lights had been strung far and wide around the town square park so that it was easy to navigate. You see, Leo had also been bestowed to me, in a manner of speaking. He used to be Nan's familiar, but she'd cast a necromancy spell so that he could stay behind and teach me the ways of our craft. The consequences of dark magic were well known. Unfortunately, Leo had taken the brunt of them as a result. Even so, Leo handled his idiosyncrasies rather well.
It's not like I had a choice, Raven. Besides, my somewhat gruff appearance earns me special treats from several of the elderly residents in town. I think it's the latest GQ trend, and my resemblance to those men with scruff on their faces and all the stylish fashion magazines. Let's not mess with my good fortune, shall we?
Leo had been a normal everyday black cat before the necromancy spell. Now, well, let's just say he resembled something out of one of those gremlin movies from back in the 1980s. After those critters got wet. He had tufts of fur standing out every which way, crooked whiskers, and a tail that resembled a bent coat hanger. He had also somehow managed to acquire orange stripes after having miraculously survived Nan's efforts at casting dark magic. I hadn't even touched on the fact that his left eye bulged out more than his right, and even more so when he was stressed. Combine that with a somewhat selective memory glitch, and he could have been something out of a sci-fi movie assisting Dr. Frankenstein. All the same, Leo was the best thing that had ever happened to me.
I hate it when you do that. It's like putting a fresh coat of paint on an outhouse. You always twist things so that I don't even know which way is up. It's like when the good old sheriff tosses me a compliment. I never know what to do with those things. They're like a subscription to Reader's Digest. They just keep piling up. It's not like I have anything nice to say in return. He's absolutely ordinary in every respect. And don't use this commercial excuse of a holiday to change my mind either. The spirit of giving? Bah, humbug.
As I'd mentioned earlier, Leo had been in a bad mood for the last month or so, ever since his nemesis had gone into hibernation. To Leo, that meant he'd lost another annual battle in the squirrelpocalypse to end all wars. That was until next season.
Go ahead, rub my failure in my face. That Skippy is a wily opponent. You shouldn't underestimate him. That's how he beats you.
See what I mean?
Well, I had a plan to get Leo out of this funk he was in. I wasn't only bringing Sheriff Liam Drake a cup of coffee in order to steal a kiss, but it was also to distract Leo from his state of melancholy. We were now close enough to the large Christmas tree that my plan should commence in 3, 2, 1.
Lights! All the shiny lights! Thousands of them, Raven! And they twinkle!
All the residents were used to Leo accompanying me everywhere, though he did have the ability to become invisible when he wanted. Seeing as the middle of town square was quite cozy with all the propane-fueled standing heaters positioned in discreet areas, the pads of his paws would be kept safe from the harsh reality of the bitter cold sidewalks and streets. This type of setting was literally a carefree playground for cats, as long as they stayed out of the town's Christmas tree and didn't break any ornaments. Leo's back end was wiggling in delight as his green, uneven gaze was solely focused on the twinkling lights and shiny trinkets hanging from the branches of the gigantic Christmas tree. It was a good thing the pine was anchored securely so that it couldn't topple over, as well as the ornaments being large enough so that Leo wouldn't be able to knock them to the ground without considerable effort.
"I see Leo is finally in better spirits," Liam said, coming from behind me to wrap his arms around my waist.
My scarf fell below my chin as he rested his cold cheek against mine, though that wasn't surprising since he'd been outside most of the day, officially overseeing the town's festivities.
"Did you bring me a coffee, Miss Marigold? If yes, then you deserve a kiss."
"Why, yes, Sheriff Drake," I replied with a laugh, finally turning around to claim that kiss he'd just promised. "I did make you a special cup of Colombian Supremo." Liam had already taken the to-go cup from my gloved hand, lifting it to his mouth until he paused in question. He arched an eyebrow before lowering it with just a bit of skepticism. "Not that kind of special, Liam. You're quite safe from the women's auxiliary." Those women were quite the teetotalers, every single one of them. I playfully hit him in the arm, knowing full well that he'd been referring to my holistic tea blends and not alcohol. My nan had gotten into the business when she'd wanted to use her craft to help the residents of Paramour Bay, and I'd naturally followed in her footsteps. Well, maybe with a few bumps along the way. Witchcraft wasn't necessarily easy for an accident-prone witch. Anyway, those townsfolk who suffered from arthritis now had a few extra skips in their steps, just as those with common colds found they could drink a certain tea and feel better within a fairly short time period. There was nothing more rewarding than to know my gift could help others, and that included most of the members of the women's auxiliary. I guess you could say I was their own personal Mrs. Claus, bestowing the gift of health whenever I could. I'd been given a gift as well. Liam's acceptance of who and what I was. It was a relief to no longer need to hide my lineage from someone who was important to me.
"How was your day?" Liam asked, enjoying the rich Colombian coffee I'd made him right before closing up the shop. "Did you have a steady stream of traffic?"
"Yes, and sales were fantastic," I replied, very pleased with the holiday sale I'd been running on my seasonal inventory. "Otis even came into the shop today to special order a few accessories that Karen has been wanting to add to her tea collection. Hey, did your sister get back to you about spending the holidays here?" Otis and Karen Finley had raised Liam and his sister after they'd lost their mother in the middle of their teenage years. Liam had even followed in Otis's footsteps, entering the New York City Police Academy. Upon Otis's retirement as sheriff of Paramour Bay, Liam had returned home to take his position as the town's only peace officer.
"My sister has decided that she's taking that trip to Europe that she's been putting off for years. Said something about the ticket prices being too good to pass up."
Liam lifted a hand when Monty, who owned the hardware store across the street, called out hello to us.
"Are we still on for dinner at the diner? Trixie has shepherd's pie on the menu for this weekend only as a special holiday treat."
"You distracted me on purpose, Raven. That wasn't very nice."
6:30 sound good?" I asked, wondering why Leo was back so quick. He'd plopped himself down next to me, licking his paw and eyeing me with disgust.
I glanced over my shoulder to make sure that the Christmas tree was still intact and not on fire. I was pretty certain that he couldn't do any harm to it, but one could never be sure. I breathed a sigh of relief when every ornament still seemed to be in one piece. I have some errands I want to—
What could be wrong now?
Liam muttered underneath his breath when there seemed to be a bit of commotion over by the petting zoo.
First one of the ice sculptures was knocked over, and now this? Little Bobby Hurst better not have fed those reindeer any more candy canes.
He already tried to give them a dose of sugar from the sugar cookies, much to the dismay of the owner.
I winced when I realized I hadn't thought this whole distraction thing through with Leo. What if Bobby Hurst hadn't been the reason everyone seemed to be scattering in every random direction? Had Leo somehow managed to convince the reindeer into stampeding through the town?
I'd gladly take credit where credit is due, but I didn't have a thing to do with whatever is going on over there. Honestly, I'm offended you would even think such a thing.
Reindeer?
I'm too busy trying to come up with a new plan for the spring offensive to stop the impending squirrelpocalypse.
Really? I asked Leo, not worrying about other people seeing me talk to my cat, since their sole focus was on all the hullabaloo on the opposite side of town square. Liam had already begun making his way through the throngs of residents, now vying for a good place to see what all the uproar was about.
You chased Mindy's tabby rescue all through her boutique until Cupcake had clawed her way through most of the sweater rack.
That orange hairball looked at me wrong. What was I supposed to do? You can't let that kind of thing slide. It just mushrooms from there if you don't put your paw down.
Cupcake is only a year and a half old, and twice as small as you, I countered, hoping that Leo would see that his actions bordered on violent intimidation. I understood that he was simply looking for a distraction to occupy his time, now that his yearly battle with the local squirrels had been postponed until the spring, but that didn't give him the right to terrorize the quite ordinary domestic pets around town. What we need is a good mystery to keep you occupied.
Have you lost your ever-loving mind? Never mind. I already know the answer to that question. It was a casualty of your first day in town.
I'm not jinxing us, I replied confidently, already knowing that Leo was referring to karma. I wasn't worried in the least about tempting our fate, though. Once Halloween had come and gone, Paramour Bay had been peacefully quiet and devoid of any murders, thefts, or arsons related to the supernatural.
I was thinking more along the lines of a small mystery. You know, maybe helping Elsie find her favorite pair of reading glasses. They've been missing for the last 2 days. Besides, there are other mysteries to solve besides the odd murder.
The Halloween debacle was a long story, but I could summarize. You see, my great-aunt still belonged to the Windsor Coven, the members of which just so happened to be at war with one another. I'd officially gotten Aunt Rowena to believe that me, my mother, and my friends wanted no part in a war between the two factions. I'd finally grown a backbone and managed to use it properly.
Raven?
I looked down at Leo, waiting for a snarky comment about my confidence level having inched up a bit over the last month and a half. Instead, his left eye protruded a bit as he stared at something behind me.
Don't do it. Don't turn around. And if you do, which I know you will, I'd like to go on record that it wasn't me. I had nothing to do with chasing that mouse up his pant leg.
With that kind of introduction, I couldn't help myself. I looked over my shoulder to find Santa Claus himself standing behind me, looking a bit melancholy, as worry lines appeared between his bushy eyebrows. I have to say, I was pretty impressed with the likeness from the pictures. The council had done a fantastic job of picking this particular Santa out of the cast of characters we usually had.
If you say so. Personally, I think his beard could have been a bit longer.
I should apologize on Leo's behalf, I began, pausing long enough to search for the right words. What could one say when their cat wreaked havoc on a holiday display?
He's been a bit lonely ever since the local squirrels went into hibernation, and he's just looking for something to keep him busy.
No need to apologize, dear,
Santa Claus replied with a smile that didn't quite reach his blue eyes. We stood in silence for a moment, observing the crowd as they all began to fan out in groups around town square. Something had definitely happened at the petting zoo, and Liam was directing the horde.
My lead reindeer has gone missing.
You might want to step away slowly, Raven. Make no sudden moves toward him. It appears that this Santa Claus is taking his duties a little bit too seriously, if you get my drift. The opioid problem is striking everywhere and affecting people on all walks of life.
Missing? I was pretty sure that this Santa Claus hadn't been close enough to the petting zoo to know what exactly had happened to cause all the commotion. A thought occurred to me. Is this one of the activities scheduled for tonight? Find the red-nosed reindeer? That's a clever one.
I would never use my reindeer in such a manner, my dear.
Santa had topped his outfit off with those gold-rimmed glasses, which he now adjusted on the end of his bulbous nose.
The sheriff believes that my lead reindeer has just wandered off, but I don't believe that to be the case. This doesn't bode well for my trip around the world. How will I find my way through the fog and snow?
Are we really going to stand here and listen to this malarkey? Raven, it's obvious he's a few presents shy of a full sleigh. We don't even know that one of those antlered brutes is missing.
Raven, could you go look in the alleyway behind the shops?
Liam called out, pointing toward tea leaves and eaves. There was a narrow alleyway that ran behind my tea shop for regular deliveries to most of the stores.
One of the reindeer has gone missing.
Coincidence, merely coincidence, Raven. He could have guessed.
How did you... My voice trailed off as I realized Santa Claus was no longer in my vicinity. A quick look revealed that he was making his way back to his throne, where some of the children were lining back up to pay him a personal visit now that their parents were distracted. It appeared that duty called, but I'd love to know how he knew about the reindeer. Odd.
It's not surprising. You do tend to attract the more eccentric sort.
It didn't take me long to check the alleyway. A few other residents had done the same, and we made our way back to town square in a small group. I managed to spot Liam still standing near the petting zoo, so I made my way over to him to let him know that I was willing to do whatever I could to help facilitate the safe return of the reindeer. What happened? I asked, after letting him know that there was no sign of the large animal in the alleyway. Did someone unlatch the gate?
The owner isn't sure,
Liam replied, unhooking the flashlight from his utility belt. He handed it to me, already ensuring that the switch had been turned on.
He did a head count, which he claims to do every 15 minutes. One of the reindeer is missing, but the gate wasn't open. I'm fairly sure that he didn't fly out of the pen either. Everyone in the vicinity is claiming they didn't see a thing. The mayor is with the owner now, reassuring him that we'll have this situation resolved in a matter of a few minutes.
I glanced back over to where Santa was listening intently to a little girl's list of Christmas wishes, deciding not to burden Liam with my suspicions. My palm hadn't reacted in any way, so the Santa Claus whom the town council had hired bore no ill intentions toward the residents or the animals. I might have forgotten to mention that energy formed in the palm of my right hand whenever danger was near, and no such reaction was happening at the moment.
If you recall, we have determined that your witch signal is a bit defective at times.
Leo and I will go check the alleyway behind the tea shop again, I promised, lacking any better alternative. I adjusted my scarf for the upcoming search. I mean, how hard can it be to find a reindeer in Paramour Bay?
You realize that this might be the consequences of that jinx you wrangled up earlier.
Leo, I didn't jinx us, I disputed, as we came upon the sidewalk, stepping up while being mindful of any slick spots. One of the children could have simply opened the gate to the pen while the owner wasn't looking. Like you said, the reindeer probably walked away in hopes of finding Bobby Hurst and another dose of sugar. I imagine that caribous are very highly intelligent animals.
You must be thinking about Skippy and his tribe of ninja squirrels, because you couldn't possibly be referring to those thick-antlered brutes. Have you seen the size of those things? Their noses are bigger than my face, which doesn't leave a lot of room for brains. I bet they can sniff out a granular speck of sugar from a mile away. We should check the bakery.
It was a good thing I could hide my smile behind my scarf, because I'm pretty sure that Leo was attempting to figure out which direction the reindeer had wandered off. My plan of distracting him had worked, just a little differently than I had originally planned. Truthfully, the bakery wasn't such a bad idea. I did have to wonder how no one had seen a 500-pound animal walking out of our rather crowded town square.
This is where the jinx comes in, Raven. Don't you see? You might have actually gotten us involved with an honest-to-goodness reindeer napping.
Chapter 2.
I heard about all the commotion last night. Did they ever find poor Rudy?
Heidi Connolly asked as she breezed into the tea shop the next morning. She was wearing one of her expensive pantsuits from when she'd lived in New York City. Either she had an appointment with one of the founding families of our little town, or she was making a day trip into the Big Apple for business.
Hi, Leo. Did you know that Cupcake now has her own pink, fluffy pillow in the boutique's display window? I don't know why you don't like her. She's got the sweetest disposition, always eager to be scratched behind her ears.
My best friend was like a mini tornado of glitter and all things frivolous, invariably full of energy and optimism. She was one of the only two humans who I'd informed of my not-so-recently discovered supernatural secret. Not that I was part of my ancestors' coven, but confiding in Heidi and Liam had gone against one of the top 5 rules established by the Governing Council, which was a fairly common stance taken by most organized covens, from what I understood. Needless to say, I wasn't my fellow witches and warlocks' most favorite person. Not that they were fully aware of my indiscretions.
That orange con artist has everyone fooled, even my beloved Heidi. This moment of realization has brought a tear to my slightly bulging eye. I'm not sure how, but this has all got to be tied in with the squirrelpocalypse. I'm going to be forced to invade my emergency edible catnip treat supply, aren't I? I was saving those for a truly momentous occasion. They are the last of my one-time organic Honduran premium acquisition. Truly a primo year for the Honduran crop, you know. Unequaled in decades of experimental catnip quality enhancement efforts.
Get this,
Heidi said before I could answer her, walking straight to the small coffee station I'd set up in order for my customers to sample a variety of products.
I have a meeting with Cora Barnes to go over her year-end numbers. I thought for sure she was going to find another accountant when she discovered that I was the one who'd taken over the firm from Beetle. It's not like I haven't tried to touch base with everyone in town. But Cora never saw fit to respond to any of my calls. Yesterday afternoon, bam, there was this voice message out of nowhere, asking for a meeting.
Okay, the reason for the coffee samples might have been a tiny white lie. I'd always been a covert coffee lover, through and through. Besides, I'd made sure that the coffee selection only took up one of the high-top tables so that I could maintain the original tenor of my Nan's tea shop. I was currently expanding our selection of premium coffee station accruements while ensuring that we continued to provide for the experienced tea aficionado.
Cora only has a problem with my mother, as far as I know,
I refuted from my position on the stool behind the counter. I then thought over my statement. Well, she doesn't like me very much either, but you've got the experience of a major New York City firm backing you up. That's prestigious in the eyes of her circle. Cora and Desmond Barnes would never forgo that kind of opportunity to up their ante. Heidi had cut a deal with her old firm, and the contract she'd put in place had definitely been a gold mine. She had the best of both worlds, while owning her own business, taking over an established setup that Beetle had structured here in our small town, all the while living close to her best friend. I wasn't sure what had been included in the fine print of the sale of the town's only bookkeeping business, but it had definitely been to her advantage, from the looks of Heidi's new briefcase.
I never thought of it that way, Heidi said with a frown.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.